If you want to know what it takes to rebuild a marine raw water pump, or if you own a marine engine and you want to anticipate your future, or if you're just curious about the physics behind how these intriguing little engines work, then this video is for you. Good morning. When I first discovered a few drops of salt water underneath the front of the engine, my first thought was a leaking hose. But look at this. When the engine is running, we've got an impressive leak out the weep hole of our salt water pump. Let's fix it. This is my raw water strainer in the back here, and the first thing I'm going to do is loosen this thing off. Now you might wonder, what's the point of doing this? Why don't you think about that for a second? Here's the OEM Seacock on the Yanmar SD20 sail drive. It's got that terrible corkscrew design, and one day I'll swap it for a ball valve. With this style valve, you may think you've closed it when it's not completely shut. Here's a clip I made when I swapped out the impeller last year. Now I'm thinking, did I forget to close the Seacock? I'm alone, it's kind of comical. What would you do? Incidentally, this is a pretty good test to verify that your Seacock is able to completely close. You see, salt water goes through the Seacock and then is routed up above the ocean level to the water strainer and then down to the pump. But in contrast with normal anti-siphon loops, there's no anti-siphon valve. This is because the system is using the weight of your boat to force a free stream of water to the inlet side of the pump. Any leak in the hose will not stop until the boat sinks. Of course, the quick solution is to raise the free end of the tubing up above the level of the ocean outside, and the leakage instantly stops. Tape it into place and Bob's your uncle. A better plan, before you take the hose apart, is to crack open that strainer and break the siphon. So even a failed Seacock will not slowly drip seawater into your bilge after you go back to the workshop with pump in hand. Okay, let me show you something interesting that Yanmar has done. This is a 3GM 30FC engine, but if you notice here on the engine serial number, there's an E in front of it. And what that E designates is that it was assembled in Europe. Now, as far as I know, the only thing that they really put on in Europe was the saltwater pump, which is made in Sweden. What that means is that Yanmar have a different parts list that they use, the so-called YEU parts list. Now this time, before I take the belt off, I'm going to try and get the belt pulley off, and I'll use this pulley to try and hold it against this. If I can get it off in the boat, that's great. If I can't, I can do it on the workbench with my power tools. This is a 13 millimeter socket, and it doesn't want to move, so I'll have to do that later. Okay, next I'll get the hoses off. This is going to leak some water. Real tradesmen know there's a Zen philosophy to efficient workflow. Put the bolts back into the holes for safekeeping. You're less likely to lose them or mix them up. All right, let's have a look at this. You can see inside there, there's the green discoloration of oxidized copper back here. Let me give you a better look at that through the magnifier. So that's the weep hole right there, leaking out of that thing. Leaks out by gravity. All right, let's take the pulley off. This is 13 millimeter. I've got a strap wrench on the pulley. That was easy. Now this next nut is said to be a left-hand thread, and it feels loose. Look at that. And I can just spin it off by hand. It's a 19 millimeter. There's an external circlip there, and you can see there's a bit of moisture inside this part of the bearing, which is a little unusual in and of itself. Okay, I got about four different kinds of snap ring pliers, and the one I like the most actually is this one by Channel Lock. And you can see when I squeeze here, it widens, but the neat thing about it is when I flick the switch, when I squeeze it, narrows much more like a regular set of pliers. You see how I held my hand over it, because those tend to go flying. This looks reusable. Now some versions of this pump have a paper gasket, but this one does not. This one has an O-ring. Now everybody knows there's a special wrench for this, but everybody knows it also doesn't have one. but it's pretty easy to take care of. And this impeller, I just changed it a year ago. This impeller is fine. There's no missing vanes. I have a replacement O-ring for this, but I'm not sure if I need it. Okay, I've got the magnifier situated so you can see the seal in the back there. Now that seal presses out from the inside out. And they say that if you want to just get the seal out, you could just stick something in there and then push it out. But we're going to take the whole shaft out anyway to have a look at the bearings in the shaft, so I'm not going to need to worry about that. But if you were just changing the seal, you could stick a little wire with a little hook on the end and just push that seal out, and the seal comes out this way towards you. The bearings actually feel fine, but you can see there's a layer of rust in here, so clearly water has gotten in on this side at least. I think while I'm here, I may as well just change out both bearings if I can find a replacement for this one. Now before I press this shaft out, I want to determine the position it was in before we started to work on it. And so I think you'll notice that the end of this stub is deep to the recess here, because you don't want it hitting the end. And if I measure here across the flat spot with the O-ring moved, I just get a hair over 3 millimeters depth. So I'm going to use a press here, partly because I can. It might actually be easier and faster to do it without a press, but I'm going to use the press. Now, the question that always arises is, which way do you push it out? And as usual, there's no dealer service manual to help you, but we do know that the external snap ring was here. And so that snap ring was designed to hold the bearing from coming out this way. And so it makes logical sense to push the bearings out this way. Now there's another snap ring inside, which is an internal snap ring. And we'll see about that, but let's just get it started. Okay, there's the first bearing. And there's the second. Wow, look at that. Now, getting a little closer look at this, this one still feels nice and smooth. This is the outer one closest to the pulley. But this one here, just listen to this. That bearing is shot. Water got into it, and it's shot. So both have to come off. Now, I'm lucky enough to have a bearing puller kit. That thing goes like this, and I'll use it with the press to get this out. And we'll start by pushing this one out that way, and then the other one will have a look. There's another snap ring in there as well we'll have to get off. But if you don't have one of these, you could somehow use a vise and get something behind and then pry this off. Or a puller set. You could use a puller set that presses on here and pulls the bearing off this way. But let's just use the press. So I put this nut back on flush just so it'd have a little more surface area to press on. Now with the big outer ring off, you can see there's a spacer here. I'll just take that off. And then between the two bearings is another snap ring. Do you see it right there? It's an internal snap ring. And so I'm going to use my snap ring pliers and take that one off. Okay, I just spent 5 minutes playing with this thing. Finally, I've got it out of the groove. There we are. But that's actually not as easy as it usually is. I didn't break it. They say these tend to break. And in fact, the parts guy that I worked through got me another one of these, but I'm going to swap it out anyway, but I probably could have reused this one. Okay, I want to push this off, the bearing off this way, so I got to put it down like so. There we go. Okay, so the thing I was most worried about was that there'd be damage to the underlying stainless steel, and I do see some residue from the seals, but I'm not seeing any major damage to the stainless steel, so I think the shaft is good. Okay, now let's take the lip seal out, so I'm going to use this seal puller. Well, that came out easy. And you can see the spring deep inside there. It's all rusty. See that? Thank you.
I've got a 9/16 socket, and I've got the first bearing, and I'm just pressing it on, and it's going very easily. All right, now you can see there I put the new circlip on, and I'm about a millimeter too far, so I'm just going to tap it back with a hammer. Okay, next is the sleeve, bit of oil, and then the big bearing. Let's press that on. Oh, it's going in very easy. All right, I think there's enough of a groove to get this circlip on now. What's the fun in a project without a homemade tool? I made this little tool for another purpose, but this actually works pretty well with this. I can use this to screw on this left-hand nut. Now, it wasn't on very tight before, and the purpose of the left-hand nut is to get the position right for the pulley. That's the wrong way. And then now the seal. This next would be a debatable issue, but I'm going to put a little bit of RTV Ultra Black on here. Many would not. I'm just going to put it on the outside of the lip. Now comes the impeller. Now I use vegetable glycerin. Buy the little packets from the Okay, there's something really interesting about how these pumps work. When you look at that, you'd think, well, it's pumping in that direction, but no, when you turn it this way, it's pumping in this direction. It draws fluid in at a low pressure here with a big volume, and you watch what happens to that volume as it goes around this little bevel here, this cam squeezes it down, so the pressure here just before it reaches the orifice here is a lot higher, and it squirts it that way, so the fluid goes in here around the outside and then out that way. Now for this last seal here, I'm going to use silicone paste rather than glycerin, and I'm sure that'd be a controversial topic as well, but I find silicone paste really good at preventing leaks, and it's just as inert. And it's a little bit more viscous than the glycerin, but on the other hand, I think it probably lasts longer. I think the glycerin is gone within hours of the pump turning on. I think this looks a lot nicer with the paint off of it. Ha ha ha. I forgot to put this bracket on, and the bracket has to go on before the pulley comes on, so I'm going to have to take that pulley off. So while I'm at it, I'm going to replace these two hoses here. This is the one I'm going to do today. It's the one that hooks into the saltwater pump. That's the part number right there. Okay, now I want to check to see if the belts are lined up, and it's going to be even harder for you to appreciate it than me. It looks like they're pretty close. It almost looks like this might be a little bit too far out. Now, there are laser things that you can put on these belts to line them up more exactly, but I'm just going to put it on the way it was on before. You could adjust that by adjusting the size of the shims around the pulley. But for now, let's just bolt it all together and see how it works. So at this point, most guys would open up the seacock, put the lid on the strainer, and then fire up the motor to get rid of the air bubbles in the line. But as you know, pumping air is not a forte for these little pumps. These impeller pumps can be damaged by too much air. And so what I tend to do is I take a glass. I've got a cup of water here, and I'm just going to use this cup and fill up that strainer with water to try and get rid of as much of the air pocket as I can leading up to the pump. And that should hopefully allow it to lubricate itself as effectively as possible and clear those air bubbles effectively. For those of you who own a similar pump, here are a few more details that may save you some cash. You'll probably need two bearings and a lip seal. Look at that huge difference in price between the OEM Italian bearing and the Chinese generic. In my opinion, that price difference is too high and not worth it. Okay, well, you saw me do this with a professional tool set, but the reality is you don't need all those fancy tools to get this done. A real pro would be able to improvise with a hammer and a block of wood, maybe with a hole drill and a few hand tools, and you got her done. So if this video helped you out and you want to see more of them, hit like or subscribe or leave a comment. I'd love to hear what others say. Thanks for watching.